Let me tell you a story how I almost became a stand-up comedian. This was in New York some years ago, and I was, well, was chairing a session of the doctors, in Indian doctors in the US, and Hillary Clinton was supposed to address them. So Hillary Clinton was not to be seen anywhere. So they asked me to speak to keep the audience engaged. So how long? I said, till Hillary Clinton comes. I had no idea where to start and how to go. So I went ahead and heroically went forward. And I almost exhausted all my medical jokes, because it was all doctors. And then I could see some movement in the audience. So I was wondering what had happened. They were all looking in some direction. So I turned back and found Hillary Clinton standing there. So I thought I'll stop and sit down. Then Hillary Clinton said, no, continue, that story sounds good. So he continued, and I finished and sat down. He came up to me and said, you are the ambassador of India? I said, yes. Will you ever lose this job? I said, very soon. Then I offer you a job as stand-up comedian in the United States. But I lost that opportunity because Hillary Clinton did not win the elections. If she had won the election, maybe she would have taken me as a stand-up comedian in the White House. Well, anyway, now today that is not the topic. I'm going to talk to you about diplomacy, of all things, in a world unknown. There is only one constant thing in this world, which is what Robert Browning said. God is in his heaven and all is right with the world. That is the only certain thing in this world. Everything else uncertain, everything is unknown. But what do? We depend on that we have this God holding us, but hold never holds you, right? And the uncertainty you have to face yourself. And what do? You cannot change the system, but you adjust yourself to the system. Again, a funny story. When Dr. Radhakrishnan went to Washington as the president, he was received on the White House lawns by President Kennedy. And Kennedy came to receive him, and it was pouring rain, and the helicopter landed in the White House lawns. And he went up to the president and said, Mr. President, I'm very sorry. We haven't yet found the technology to change the weather. So he was being very proud. But Radhakrishnan, it's the wrong slide. So Radhakrishnan said, Your Excellency, don't worry. Centuries ago, we learned how to live with the weather. That's what we do. Whatever technology you may develop, whatever else you may try to change the world, you cannot. So what do? In this unknown world, what we do is basically adjusting ourselves to what is around us. And then you have to work your way around. And then there are conflicts, there are problems, there are difficulties, so many things happen. And you somehow face them with this particular assurance in mind that God is in his heaven and all is right with the world. And therefore, we have had every century, every age is unknown. There is no predictability of what you see around us. And that is why diplomacy became necessary. Is there an alternative to war? Is there an alternative to conflict? And diplomacy is an alternative to conflict. In fact, they say diplomacy is war by other means. And people say that diplomacy is the oldest profession in the world. I'm not forgetting the other oldest profession. And why? Because three people once decided to argue it out. Whose profession is the oldest? A doctor, an engineer, and a diplomat. So the doctor said, mine is the oldest profession. Because after creating Adam, the first thing was to do a surgery on him so that he can take his backbone. Some people say it is a rib, but actually it's the backbone. And then create Eve. And therefore surgery is the oldest profession. The engineer said, nothing doing. Even before God created Adam and Eve, he had to create this universe. And how did he create this universe? He had to create it out of the chaos. So engineering is the oldest profession. So the diplomat had the last laugh. He said, who do you think created the chaos in the first place? So that is the oldest profession. My profession is the oldest because we are the ones who create chaos. And then we try to resolve them. But interesting thing is, gods have been diplomats before. Have you heard of the two famous diplomats in mythology? Hanuman. Hanuman was the oldest diplomat, because presuming that Rama came before Krishna, obviously. So, what did he do? He was the special envoy of Rama, and he went with a mission of peace. Alright? And then he pleaded with Ravana to let Sita go, or at least let him see Gita, Sita, etc. And then nothing had happened, and then he was threatened with extinction. He said, we'll kill you. You come to this place, we are not going to let go. But he was the ideal diplomat because he had also carried his nuclear button with him. Most of our diplomats, we are let off like that, and the Prime Minister tells you, as Rajiv Gandhi told me once, we'll make a sacrifice of you. Don't worry, go and do this. He did say to me. So here, he didn't have to do that. And so he did more than what a diplomat should be doing. So he did more than that and destroyed Sri Lanka, and then he led this whole war to destroy and kill Ravana. That is, I think, a diplomatic story went haywire, but actually he had the capacity to deal with it. Somebody mentioned Krishna. What did he do? He also went as a special envoy of the Pandavas and then pleaded with the Kauravas to give them 5 houses, 5 kingdoms, 5 houses, 1 house, or a little piece of land, everything that he pleaded for. He used all his diplomatic skills and found himself wanting, and therefore he had to lead the Kaurava war. So this is how diplomacy was born. And diplomacy is relevant in every age, whether we know the contours of that age or it is unknown to us. And so we have to invent all the time. And I'll just touch upon a couple of times in history as to how diplomacy has developed and how we have landed up today in a totally uncertain situation. There are some predictable things. You know, it's after the Second World War, the leaders of the world decide that there shall be no war. And the United Nations decided, and the United Nations was instituted to save the generation, succeeding generations from the scourge of war. And the UN succeeded. Why? Because there were only 800 wars since UN was established. And there was no Third World War. And they claim that UN is there, there's no Third World War, so we did it. We claim like that. No? So something happens and you happen to be there, and you say because of you. That is what the United Nations did. But if you look through those years of the Cold War, then you will realize the extent to which we went to the point of extinction. In 1962, I'm not going to talk about the China war, something more significant happened in the world was the Cuban Missile Crisis, where these two gentlemen were almost on the verge of destroying the world. Because Kennedy told Khrushchev that if you do not remove the nuclear weapons from Cuba, I'm going to use this button. And he gave him a deadline. And the whole world was in tenterhooks that evening, when this deadline was about to finish. So Kennedy called all his advisors into his chamber and said, I want all of you to assure me, I am going to click this button and it's going to destroy the Soviet Union entirely. But before that happens, will the Soviet Union launch a missile against us? Can you give an assurance that this will not happen? And he looked at the eyes of all his advisors, everybody turned away because they could not give that assurance. And then he said, I'm not launching the missile against the Soviet Union. At the same time, in the Kremlin, Khrushchev was also asking the same question. And he said, okay, then we remove the weapons from Cuba. And that is how we are all saved. We would not have been here in this world if that had not happened. That is diplomacy, in the sense of practical terms, because we always say diplomacy is the art of the possible. Now today, we have an uncertain world. And here we have the figures of uncertainty. Mr. Trump, Mr. Xi Jinping, and Mr. Narendra Modi. You know about this world when it was born. It was actually born in India in 2014. Mr. Narendra Modi was elected Prime Minister because of the change that had taken place in the world. We did not realize it at that time, but in 2016, the world became absolutely unbelievably unknown. Then people turned to us and said, aren't you the ones who started it? You elected a rightist government in Kerala, now in India, and the whole world is rightist, right? Because we had elected a rightist government before. Mr. Vajpayee was also a rightist government head, but he was not Mr. Narendra Modi. He changed the focus, India's foreign policy's focus. How did he do that? He started saying that I need only three things. No lecture like Pandit Nehru used to give the United Nations. We want disarmament, we want decolonization, we want equitable distribution of wealth, etc., etc. But he didn't say that. He said, I'll tell you what I want. Right? Mr. Modi's message is, here is a great country, India. Here is a great Prime Minister, Mr. Modi. And we are willing to do things to you, provided you do things for us. Truly transactional. That kind of relationship is what he has in mind. He does not hide his ambitions for the country or for himself. And he tries to project himself as somebody who can do good for others in return for the good that he can get from the world. So he wants only three things: security for the country, development for the country, and protection for the Indians abroad. So no other prime minister had explained his foreign policy in such specific words, what India's interests are. But in 2016, we saw the emergence of a world which probably we unknowingly had contributed to create. And that is where, when we had Brexit, nobody knew why the UK left the European Union. If today there is another referendum, I'm sure 90% will vote for staying back. Only 52% vote to go out. And for what? They still don't know why they did that, because they had no idea of UK outside the European Union. They were very comfortable. Okay, there were refugees problem. Of course, there were problems about having to pay a lot of money to European Union to remain in it. But if you get out of it, what? The Prime Minister himself did not know, and therefore he had to resign. And there is a new Prime Minister trying to negotiate it, and the people of the UK do not know why it happened. And the only reason that you can say is that the present is unsettled. It's an unknown world, and people are willing to take any chance to change the present situation. And for that, there is no better example than Mr. Donald Trump himself. Who would have chosen him if there was any hope in the existing world? If there was any hope in Hillary Clinton, nobody would have voted for Mr. Trump. But they did, because of the uncertainty of this world. And they said, let us find out somebody who may be different from others, but let him be someone who is different from somebody who has ruled us for 30 years. And therefore, Donald Trump was born, and an uncertain world is born. Today, do you know where India-US relations stand? In 2016, Narendra Modi went to the US Congress and said, here is the orchestra which we always had, India-US orchestra. But from tomorrow, you will hear a new symphony. This is what he said. India-US relations are at a point of great takeoff, and therefore, you will hear a symphony from tomorrow. But then, once Mr. Trump was elected, we do not know which symphony it will be. It will be a cacophony rather than anything else. But I must say, Mr. Trump has been good to us in various ways. He embraced Narendra Modi twice, as against 12 times that Narendra Modi embraced him. And he said nice things about India's trade. He said, the trade is not very well balanced, therefore please buy more from us, things like that. And then he talked about Afghanistan. We are all very happy when he started saying, we welcome India's cooperation in Afghanistan. You must do more. Then you know what he said? In any case, you are earning too much, so much millions of money from your trade with the United States, you might as well give something to Afghanistan. So, I don't know this world. No diplomacy seems to work. And then where do we do? That is where we end. How do we change? How do we adjust to this new world? Our policy now has not worked. If you look at 3 years of our foreign policy in this changed world, we'll see that in no relationship, except in the relationship with the United States, there has been improvement. Every country in the neighborhood, the relationship is worse. Because I don't want to talk about Pakistan and China. I don't want to talk about Doklam and surgical strikes and so on. And everywhere else, there is this anxiety as to how to deal with the modern world. And the answer seems to be to go back to the non-aligned. The word non-aligned is a dirty word, so let us not use it. We say strategic autonomy is the word. So strategic autonomy is what is needed. What has happened to India's foreign policy today is that now today we are perceived as too close to the United States. And that is why the Chinese are behaving this way. And that is why the Russians are behaving this way. And that is why the Pakistanis are behaving this way. And that is because of the unipolar world which emerged and we got close to it. And now there is a new bipolar world. I think we have to go back to a situation where we will be equally friendly with China and the United States. And this is not going to be easy because China is the most difficult neighbor we can deal with. And we cannot have a kind of relationship that we had between United States and the Soviet Union. And now it has to be United States and China, which is a much more difficult thing to do. So that is the unknown world we are wading into. I do not know what the solution is, but we need a new solution which may be the old one. Because when we were non-aligned, it did not stop us from getting close to the Soviet Union. Similarly here, you may be getting close to the United States, but at the same time, can we build bridges with China? I personally do not think it is possible because the Chinese vision is different from the Soviet vision. And therefore, here you are, the unknown, the age of the unknown in diplomacy. And tell me what you can do to resolve it. Thank you very much.